A very good afternoon to all of you. I'm Saloni Sancheti, your host for today's webinar. I'd also like to welcome our guest speaker, Ms. Meenu Patta, Advocate Meenu Patta. Thank you so much, ma'am, for accepting our invitation and joining us here today. I'd like to read out ma'am's profile. Ma'am is a lawyer and a member of the Jammu University Internal Complaints Committee. She's also the president of the National Child Development Council of Jammu and Kashmir. Along with these roles, she is the vice president of Hartal for Hamid and is the founder of Pratiki Pathshala, which is a school for underprivileged children. Once again, I'd like to welcome you, ma'am. I'd like to request all the participants to keep their videos and mic off during the session. Once the session is over, a question and answer round will be open, and then the floor will be open for question and answers. Thank you.
So, shall I start? First of all, let me know, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Okay, fine. So, shall I start?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you so much. First of all, Vidhi Parivartan, thank you so much for inviting me. I mean, it's a very important discussion. I mean, Bosch is, you know, very strong piece of legislation. So thank you for inviting me in this very important discussion. Yeah. So if I start with the Bosch Act, what is Bosch stand for? What is P-O-S-H? What does that mean? That means it's an act that is the Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace Prevention, Prohibition and Redressal Act. It's an act of 2013, which is popularly known as Bosch Act. So this act covers various issues relating to the harassment of women at workplace and aim at making the workplace a safe and non-hostile environment for women. As we all know, maybe some of them, you know, some of the listener may be law student or lawyer maybe. So they must be aware about this act, Bosch Act, which, you know, deal with the issues relating to harassment of women at workplace. So the aim of making the workplace, aim was to, you know, make this law was to just to make a workplace a safe and non-hostile environment for women by preventing, protecting, and redressing the women affected by conduct of sexual harassment. So according to this act, the sexual harassment of women at workplace is a, we all know that it's a grave offense. It's a punishable offense with fine and rigorous imprisonment. As we all know that under POSH, the crime is cognizable. What does cognizable mean? It means that police can arrest a person without warrant, of course, or even the book. Even the Constitution of India support this act as a conduct of sexual harassment result in the violation of fundamental rights of women to equality under Article 14 and 50. The violation of her right to life and right to live with dignity as mentioned in Article 21. As we all know that we all have right to dignity, which is a facet of Article 21. So this act is, you know, part of the article. This act covers Article 21 along with Article 14 and 15 of the Constitution of India. So now I would like to go, I would like to talk about the root of this act. I mean, how this act evolved, why this act has been enacted. So this root of this act arises from the heinous act done in 1992. You must all have heard about the case of Bumri Devi, the case of Vishakha versus state of Rajasthan. The judgment came in this case is 1997, in which a Dalit woman named as Bhavri Devi. I would like to mention one thing, that there is a movie, namely Bhavandar. If some people have watched that movie, you will see the case has, you know, very well, that movie has very well, you know, picturized that case. You will see the Bhavandar movie that is completely based on that, Vishakha versus state of Rajasthan. And this Dalit woman, which is her name was Bhavri Devi, who employed in a rural development program, was gang raped in retaliation of her efforts to curb the prevalent practice in child marriage. We all know that Rajasthan is, you know, known for its, you know, this child marriage, child marriage cases, and even still date, we witness a lot of child marriage cases. We have witnessed in Haryana and some of them from Rajasthan. So this Bhamri Devi was, but what it is kind of a sakhi. If you people have heard about, I'm from J&K, so here what the term is used is Asha worker, the women who go door to door to make people aware about their rights, about the new schemes that government had implemented and all these. So this Bhavari Devi was employed in a rural development program. She was gang raped in retaliation of her effort to curb the then prevalent practice of child marriage. And this case revealed the hazards that working women were exposed to on a day-to-day basis. The judgment in this case laid the foundation of Posh Act. Actually, Posh Act, what is the root behind this Posh Act is this Bhavari Devi case, actually. We see today the Supreme Court released a series of guidelines by this act in 1997. The case title is Vishakha versus State of Rajasthan. So after the judgment of this case, these guidelines were deemed as the Vishakha guidelines. People must have heard about this Vishakha guidelines. These Vishakha guidelines have come after this case. The aim of the guidelines was to reduce the act of sexual harassment of women at workplace and making workplace a safe and non-hostile environment for women. Even we say that there are, even after so many years of its enactment of this act, the conduct of sexual harassment has not been diminished. We few years back, we see Me Too movement kind of thing. So a significant number of cases go unreported, due to negligence and misrepresentation of various provisions of the act. So what is the problem in our country is that there are number of legislations, like there are strong piece of legislation, but real problem is in implementation. The law are not properly implemented. Like for women, we have DV Act, Domestic Violence Act. We have a lot of provision in IPC. We have a lot of number of acts that deals with cyber crime against women. But the problem is that these acts has not been properly implemented. Same is the case of Posh Act. I don't know the idea about the other states, but if I talk about the J&K, the Posh Act has not been properly implemented in J&K because, a company where 10 or more than 10 employees are working, it is mandatory for that workplace to, frame an internal complaint committee to deal with a complaint of sexual harassment. But I have seen so many companies here, I have seen so many workplaces here who have not implemented, who don't have any IC committee in their workplace. So I don't think so it has been properly implemented in our UT J&K, but I must say that it should be implemented because even there is a penalty provision for those companies who will not follow the guidelines issued under Posh Act. So let's move on. So what is sexual harassment? What amounts to sexual harassment? What is workplace? How to file complaint to sexual harassment at workplace? What is the time limit in filing a complaint of sexual harassment at workplace? Most of these questions, terms are misrepresented and misunderstood by a significant amount of people. Through this discussion, I aim to help those people who are listening to me right now to understand the various definition of this act. Actually, women are not aware about what constitutes sexual harassment. They only consider that when a man touch a woman, that only physical touch is only a sexual harassment. The main concept behind the sexual harassment, what constitutes sexual harassment, or what is workplace, what is the definition of workplace under Posh Act? People are not aware about this act. And there are some landmark judgments recently, first judgment is passed by recently in 2021 by Rajasthan High Court, where they made it a bit gender neutral act, because now even male or female both can file a complaint of sexual harassment before internal complaint committee. So you see that the area of this act is going to be wide day by day. So now I will discuss about what constitutes sexual harassment. What is sexual harassment? What is the meaning of sexual harassment under this act? So let's start with the most basic question that comes with this act. This question is the first and foremost that comes in once wherever one discusses about the POSH Act. Still, most of the people don't have clarity about it. Whenever this question arises, one think of a physical touch. As I earlier said, that we generally women consider as a physical touch is only a sexual harassment. Only physical harassment can be considered as a sexual harassment. However, the ambit of the term sexual harassment is much wider than just physically, you know, harassing someone. So explaining the definition of sexual harassment according to Section 2, Clause 9 of the POSH Act, the conduct of sexual harassment can be physical. Please please listen it carefully. The sexual harassment can be physical, it can be verbal, it can be written, or even visual. In visual form, the sexual harassment can be done. So it can be direct physical advances like showing pornography, sending messages, etc., or indirect or implied, like referring quid pro quo statements, like if someone is, you know, superior in your position, like for example, a lady who is working in a company and she is she's, you know, the person who is you know, harassing that woman is superior in position in that company. So that is a kind of quid pro quo statement. So impliedly threatening the subordinate female employees employment status, these all constitute the sexual harassment. So an essential feature then distinguish the conduct of sexual harassment from other is that the conduct of sexual harassment, whether it is direct or indirect, is unwanted and unwelcome by the recipient. Like for example, an aggrieved woman, maybe for one woman it may not be a sexual harassment, for other women it may be a sexual harassment. So it depends upon the person to person. It may be like for example, aise cases mein hota hai, like ek women ko agar touch kar le ek male, to maybe uske liye ye normal cheez ho. It depends upon person. And dusri hi mahila ke liye jo hai can be a sexual harassment. So it depends upon person to person. So it's an essential feature that distinguishes the conduct of sexual harassment from other, that the conduct of sexual harassment, whether it is direct or indirect, must be unwanted, must be unwelcomed. Okay. So example, I would quote an example. If you are on a call with your boss, right, on a work-related call, and during your conversation, your boss referred to some quid pro quo, this for that. This quid pro quo, you know, it says that this for that, the meaning of this quid pro quo is this for that statement, and threaten your employment status, that if you don't comply, then he's liable to conduct of sexual harassment. The answer is yes. Whether it is a sexual harassment or not, of course it is sexual harassment. He's liable under the provision of POSH Act, and his conduct come under the definition of sexual harassment. Okay, so let's proceed further. Some other example of sexual harassment are like making sexually colored remarks. As I earlier said, that making sexually colored remarks, demand or request for sexual favor, promise of preferential treatment, like humiliating treatment which affects the aggrieved woman's health, offensive or hostile environment, etc. So these all are examples of sexual harassment. Now the second very important definition under POSH Act is the workplace. Now what is this workplace which has been defined under POSH Act? So with the definition of sexual harassment being understood, let's understand what does the meaning of the term workplace, which means according to POSH Act. When one hears the word workplace, he refers to the place where he works inside a premises, right? What's more interesting is the fact that workplace means a lot more than just the four walls of one office. So we cannot confine it within the four wall of your office. Workplace is, you know, covered even behind that, beyond that. The definition of workplace as given and explained in Section 2, Clause O of the Act. Please mind it, Section 2, Clause O of the POSH Act defines the term workplace. It is very wide. Right, and it includes each and every place in which a woman can face an encounter of sexual harassment. So the act adopts the principle of extended workplace. Now the question is, what is this extended workplace? Extended workplace is not just a simple workplace. What does it mean? That this means that all that places where there are a professional relation exists comes under the ambit of workplace. Like if you go for a, you know, party organized by that office, that also covered under that extended workplace, right? And thus any conduct of sexual harassment done there comes during this, as I give the example of the, you know, official party. So if a person does any conduct of sexual harassment during that party, it will also cover under the definition of sexual harassment. And that place is also considered as a workplace under the POSH Act. So there comes under the purview of the POSH Act. So some common examples of extended workplace, I'd like, as I earlier said, team meetings, cab services, hotel visit, call chats, video calls, etc., in relation to professional work, in relation to professional work. That must be understood, that every team meeting, every cab services in relation to professional work, every hotel visit, call, chats, video calls, all these covered under workplace, if it in relation to your professional work. So in short, we can say any place, either physical or virtual. This is very important, actually, because now we all are, you know, doing everything through virtual mode. So any place, either now virtual workplace is also, virtual work is also considered, you know, we are doing everything online these days. So these are also covered under workplace. So any place, either physical or virtual, where there are professional relation of the employee exists. Any place which she visits in due course of her employment can be defined as a workplace under the POSH Act, right? So I hope you people, you know, must will understand the term sexual harassment and workplace. Now we will move the next word that is very important at the POSH Act, that is complaint. What is complaint? What is the procedure of filing of complaint? And what will be the time limit under which you can file a complaint before that internal complaint committee, right? So with the definition of sexual harassment and workplace being covered, let's discuss how to file a complaint of sexual harassment at workplace. What is its procedure and what is the time limit in filing a complaint? So any woman having encountered an incident of sexual harassment should approach the internal complaints committee. As I earlier said, that any workplace with 10 or more than 10 employees, see, that the duty of the employer of that workplace, that he or she should you know, frame a committee, internal complaint committee within its workplace. That is mandatory provision. And if he do not, you know, comply with this provision, he is liable for, you know, penalty that may be imposed against him. And it is a duty of the, even the employee of that workplace, that if there is not any employee, internal complaint committee is present there, it is a duty of the employee to, you know, ask your employer to kindly start this internal complaint committee. Otherwise, you can file a complaint against that before the particular authorities. And even it depends upon the company to company. Like some of the companies even, you know, got a penalty of crores of rupees for not having the internal complaint committee. So it depends on the status of the company, right? So, okay, yeah. Any women having encountered an incident of sexual harassment should approach the internal complaint committee and then file a written complaint of the incident to the ICC. It must be within 90 days, 3 months from the date of the incident. That is very important. It must be within the 90 days of the incident. For example, if on 1st March, the sexual harassment has been happened, so it is a duty of that aggrieved woman to approach the ICC within 3 months from the date of the incident. So in case of series of incident, the complaint should be filed within 90 days from the date of last incident. So in case you are facing a series of incidents, right? So what will happen then? You can file a complaint that must be within 90 days from the date of last incident happened to you regarding your sexual harassment. In case there is no ICC, as I earlier said, in your workplace, you can approach the local complaint committee with the same complaint. There must be a local complaint committee in every district. Like I earlier said, that in J&K, there is not any local complaint committee in my district at least. So again, it's the duty of the government to frame a local complaint committee, like where a woman can approach in case her place do not have internal complaint committee. So she can approach to the local complaint committee with that written complaint, right? So So in case there is no ICC in the workplace, he should approach the local complaint committee with the same complaint. So there are numerous cases in which women are not able to file a written complaint due to many reasons. In that case, if a woman approached the ICC or, as I said, LCC, that is local complaint committee, and informed them about the same, it is a duty of the ICC, internal complaint committee, or local complaint committee, whatever it may be, to provide the woman with the required assistance she needs to file a written complaint. So, as I earlier said, this is very, strong piece of legislation. So it is a duty of the member of the ICC. Women is illiterate. She is not able to write a proper complaint. So it is a duty of the members of the ICC or LCC, whatever it may be, to help her to write a complaint and file before them, and make sure to make them to tell her that what is the procedure to file a complaint before them, right? So also the ICC and LCC may extend the time limit in case of reasonable circumstances. So it depends upon the case to case. In case of reasonable circumstances, it is the power of the ICC that they can even extend the time limit for filing a complaint that prevented the aggrieved from filing the complaint within the time, right? So after a complaint being filed, the ICC, that is the internal complaint committee, or the local complaint committee may begin the inquiry, or at the request of the aggrieved women, may settle the matter between her and the respondent through conciliation. Now, this is very important. Actually, in some of the cases, women want to settle the matter. They don't want to proceed further. They don't want to start an inquiry track. So they want to settle the matter. So it is mentioned in the POSH Act that if a woman is ready, she may settle the matter between her and the respondent through conciliation, and it must be written by ICC, the reason why she has been settled the matter, and what is the reason why she, this all should be in written form, right? So if she will not agree with the conciliation, of course, she can proceed further, and then the inquiry trial will start, as we seen civil cases. Same in the case of POSH Act, inquiry trial will start, and witnesses will come, summons will be issued, and all that. So now I would like to put some cases like that is very important, I think. First of all, I have already told you that there is one case about the Rajasthan High Court. I'm not able to recall the exact title of the case right now. Sorry for that. But it's a very recent case. A landmark judgment came in 2021 about the judgment. So what happened in this case, judgment came in this case that Rajasthan High Court held in this case that even it is not mandatory that the complainant should be women only. Even a male can be a complainant, right? So now this is gender neutral act, even male and female both can file a complaint under section POSH Act. So it is a very outstanding reform in POSH Act, and I think this should be welcome. Of course, and one thing that I would like to add is there is also one. Sorry, I am also not able to recall the name of that case also. But in that case, what happened that even the online workplace is also considered as come under the definition of workplace under the POSH Act. For example, if you are doing an online work, right? We all are doing an online work these days. So even sexual harassment happened during this online, working. So you can file a complaint, and that workplace, that online workplace, that online time in which you are doing your professional work, during that, if any sexual harassment happened, you can file a complaint against that person. So it is also very important judgment. So now I would like to conclude the session. So it is not the laws or act that make these offenses diminish, but our awareness about these laws. So I think Vidhi Parivartan has done a great job. I think it is very important actually to, people must be aware about their rights. I'm from JNK, and people, you know, here in JNK, women are not aware about their rights. We have Domestic Violence Act. It is a very strong piece of legislation. Even emotional violence is covered under this act, but women are not aware. They only consider as physical violence as violence, and emotional violence they consider it's not a violence. Okay, so I would like to say that I think awareness is very important. So it's a very actually important that every woman, every girl, every person should know their rights. It is very important. Every person should know their laws, and that these laws and acts are nothing if they are not acted upon or not used for one good. Having awareness of the provision of the act and knowing your rights never have been any harm to us, right? By the means of this lecture, I hope that the women read, women, you know, listening to me may know about the benefit of the POSH Act. And I hope that those who have been the victim of sexual harassment, if any, at workplace may break their vow of silence and raise their voice, right, against this grave act. Not only this help them, but also it encourages many of the, you know, many of the underprivileged and exploited women who are suffering this grave and aware act, they will also raise their voice against it. And we are very late in understanding that it is not okay to have this kind of act done in the workplace, right? So even today, many women think that it is okay to have such environment in the workplace, but they should know that it is not okay, right? So they should know actually, and it is never too late. We should stop justifying the act of perpetrator and start acting on what has happened and what could happen in many more women. So if we don't raise our voice against the conduct of sexual harassment at workplace, with all these things said in this lecture, you know, I conclude a quote. I have written a quote from William James that act as if what you do makes a difference. It does, right? So for this, I think I should conclude this session about the POSH Act. I have tried my best to convey every important thing regarding POSH through this lecture. I hope this will help to you people. Please let me know if I have to, you know, talk some more. Otherwise, it's okay. Is it okay? Please let me know.
It's okay, ma'am. Thank you so much for enlightening all our participants on such an interesting topic. It's time for a question and answer round. In case any of the participants have any queries or questions, they can put them in the chat box or raise their hand, and thereafter we'll unmute you guys.
Very good.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was a really informative and knowledgeable session with you today. I'd also like to thank all our participants for being patient listeners. I'm sure we can keep serving you with all such webinars, and thank you so much for joining.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.